my name's Felice, and I'm a Student Conservation Association intern with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. We're so glad you joined us for today's program, Wild Wetlands. We're going to two national wildlife refuges about an hour outside of Houston. We're going to meet park rangers, biologists, and naturalists that know a lot about wildlife and wetlands. Have you ever been to a national wildlife refuge before? These are public lands set aside for the benefit of wildlife, and there's five of them surrounding Houston. These refuges are free of charge, open 7 days a week from sunrise to sunset. They're places for you and your family to enjoy nature. At the end of this program, we will give you more information about how to find a national wildlife refuge near you. First, we're heading to Anahuac National Wildlife Refuge. It's east of Houston off I-10 near the city of Anahuac. This is Ms. Stephanie and Ms. Jessica. They're both biologists and work as park rangers at the refuge. They're going to lead us on the first half of our wetland adventure. Do you know what a wetland is? It's land or area that can be covered with shallow water or have saturated soil. This can be seasonal or year-round. There are a lot of different kinds of wetlands. They can be salt or freshwater or somewhere in between. That's known as a brackish wetland. Wetlands are really important for a lot of different reasons, including that they filter our water, reduce flooding and erosion, and most importantly, home to reptiles, birds, fish, mammals, and a lot of different invertebrates. Speaking of invertebrates, we're gonna start off with Ms. Stephanie, who's gonna tell us about a cool little critter found in the freshwater wetlands of Anahuac Refuge.
These the fishermen call toe biters because they'll go along the water and they'll actually bite your toes, so I wouldn't dare pick this one up with my hands. But something super cool that he does is he has an air bubble that he'll take with him underneath, like he's scuba diving.
Yeah, like a portable oxygen tank.
Yeah, it's super cool. So they're really neat.
And is this the largest this bug will get?
It is. This is right around full size, an adult. And I actually found this guy on the grass. So they do not have to stay in the water. They can fly around to find another pond in case one of the ponds dries up. They can just go and fly and find a new home.
Cool. And what predators does this little bug have to be worried about?
Oh yes, probably turtles, frogs. A bullfrog will eat anything it can fit in his mouth.
Wasn't that fascinating? You can find diving beetles all around the world, not just at Anahuac. As Ms. Stephanie told us, bullfrogs like to eat diving beetles, but guess what? Diving beetles like to eat tadpoles and just about anything else. Let's go to Miss Jessica to find out a little bit more about tadpoles and how they turn into frogs and toads. Check it out.
Thank you so much for being with us here at Anahuac National Wildlife Refuge. Tell us what we have here.
We have a Gulf Coast toad.
And this is found here at the wetland, but where else can you find this toad?
The Gulf Coast toad is really special because you can find this in your backyard. You can find this at your houses. It is super adaptable and versatile, which means it can live in a lot of places.
If you guys can see a little later, it has a rough, bumpy back. Tell us why that's important to this toad.
Well, toads are different than frogs. One way you can tell is that it has these bumps on its back. And contrary to popular myth, you're not gonna get warts by touching a toad. Some toads, though, will secrete a poison in the back, which means that if you handle anything, you have to wash your hands, and that poison is a defense mechanism.
Can you define secrete for us?
Yeah, secrete means it's gonna ooze or emit some sort of little poison in the back. That's the definition of secrete.
Perfect. And what is any other differences between toads and frogs that you can tell us?
Yeah, so toads and frogs, what's the difference? Well, one thing that's different about toads and frogs is how they live. And then how they live is gonna define what their bodies are adapted to. Toads are more adapted to land. And if you look, they have claws for digging and they have shorter, stumpier legs. They're more likely to crawl away than to take giant hops. They're also more likely to burrow in the ground. Another difference between toads and frogs is toads have more bumpy skin and they have shorter, fatter bodies, and they have these big glands on the sides of their face right here.
That is so interesting. Well, I definitely know I've seen some of these around my neighborhood. Are we gonna be able to see any smaller toads or maybe in a different state of its life cycle?
Well, funny thing you should ask. Sure thing. So, toads, like frogs, are amphibians, and that means they start out in water. Their eggs are laid in water, and then they become tadpoles. Now, why is this important for us? Well, this is important for us here at the Wildlife Refuge because water quality is going to affect a lot of animals. And amphibians are really, really vulnerable to pollution because they need the water in order to have their youngest stage.
That is so cool. How long does this tadpole stay a tadpole?
It's going to vary from different animals. So different species of toads might be between 28 days to sometimes even shorter, 7 days sometimes.
Oh, that's not long at all.
And this here is a little toadlet. After it's a tadpole, it's going to sprout some legs, sprout some arms, absorb its tail, crawl out of the water, and then it will be a baby toad. So this little guy will grow up and be this big later on in life. Look at the size difference.
Well, there you have it, three stages of this toad's life. And you can see this at the National Wildlife Refuge or maybe even in your backyard. Thanks so much for being here with us. We really appreciate it.
You're welcome, Felice.
Toads are really important in wetlands, but they're also important to people. Do you know what eats toads? I'll give you a hint. It's a reptile that has a nose a little bit like a pig's nose. Next, we're going to Brazoria National Wildlife Refuge to meet this mysterious little creature with the help of Miss Christina. She helps lead environmental education programs at the refuge. When she's not volunteering, she's a senior naturalist for Harris County, Precinct 1.
All right, so this is a western hognose snake. They're called hognose snakes because if you look at the tip of his nose, it's shoved upwards like a pig's nose. And they use that nose to shovel around in the leaf litter on the ground looking for amphibians to eat. These are toad eaters. They are found here in Texas. It is a native Texas snake. We have eastern hognose and western hognose snakes here in our area. This is the more common found snake here, the western. Because they are toad eaters, what they do, toads like to blow their bodies up like balloons when they get caught. So these guys, when they catch them and the toads blow their bodies up, they actually have fangs in the back of their mouth that will pop the toad like a balloon, and then they will inject a little bit of venom into them. It's not a venom that affects you or I, it only affects the toads, and that will calm the toad down in order for this snake to eat it. So this snake has some amazing behavioral adaptations. When it is disturbed, one of its defense mechanisms, as all snakes will do, is they try to look bigger and badder. And so they'll puff their bodies out. This guy will hiss really loud. He'll flatten out his neck and show you it because it makes him look like a cobra. He'll sit and rattle this little tail, even though there's no rattles. And that will make you think maybe he's a rattlesnake, which he does get mistaken for that a lot because of his patterns. But the best thing and the coolest thing about this snake is his final act before he gives up, is he will play dead. And so when he is just bothered to a point where he just doesn't think he's gonna make it, he will wiggle himself upside down, writhe around like he's dying, poop himself to smell like he's dead, stick his tongue out like he's dead, and he will literally look dead and smell dead. And the neat thing is, you could flip one that's playing dead right side up, and it'll just go right back up on its belly up, because it's not done playing dead until it's done playing dead.
So if you see a snake rolling around being all dramatic, don't panic. It's probably just a harmless hognose. Next, Miss Christina is going to tell us a little bit about snake ribs. Yes, I said ribs, and I don't mean barbecue.
This is such a cool little snake. Can you tell me, do snakes have bones?
They actually do have bones. It's a common misconception that they don't because they don't have arms and legs, but they actually do have bones. We have a skeleton here, if you can see it. A snake skeleton is just a skull, a very long backbone, and a bunch of ribs. Now snakes, their ribs are different than yours and mine. You and I have 24 ribs that are glued into place, and they're there to protect the organs in the upper half of our body. But a snake's ribs, they've got about 200 to 400 ribs that go all the way from behind their head all the way down towards their tail. And what's unique about their ribs is each rib is connected to its own muscle. And so as the muscles squeeze and relax, it moves that bone so that the ribs are moving like my fingers move. Okay, and that's how the snake is able to slither.
Did you know that we have about 75 different kinds of snakes here in Texas, but only 5 are venomous? That's right, snakes are not poisonous, they're venomous. There's a difference. But don't take any chances. If you see a snake out and about, just give it some room so it can try to get away. It's probably a lot more frightened of you, and it just wants to get back to doing snake things, like eating bugs, rats, or even other snakes. Speaking of giving it some room, this next wetland creature we definitely want to observe from afar. We're headed to Brazoria National Wildlife Refuge to meet a Texas master naturalist, Miss Ruby, who's going to tell us a lot more about this cool critter. Stay tuned.
This is American alligator, and alligators are marvelous animals. You know, they were around before the dinosaurs, and they had these, terrific adaptations, help them to survive. First, look at the coloring. It's camouflage. Baby alligators live near the shore where there's lots of weeds and grass, and all these stripes and blotches help them to blend in. As they get older, they lose most of these blotches, and they become this color all over. They look like a log sitting out there floating around. And look at the eyes. They're gorgeous. They look like your cat's eyes, don't they? See the pupil? It's a slit. Usually if the pupil is a slit, it means that they're active at night, nocturnal. And usually if the pupil is a slit, it means that they're predators. Alligators are active at night, and they definitely are predators.
Wasn't that an amazing fact about eyes? Take a moment to think about what your eyes look like. Let's hear a little bit more about American alligators.
Quite often, all you see above the water is the eyes and the nose. They can see and breathe, two important things for survival. And they can adjust how high and low in the water they want their body to be to just the right temperature. Okay, look at the nose. It's a bump. If it were flat, when they stuck their nose above the water, it would probably get splashed in. But it's a bump like my fist. And the holes for breathing are up above. So if it sticks that nose up, that's likely to get splashed. And you know what they can do? When they go underwater, they hold their breath just like you do, but they can close their nose real tight so water doesn't get in their nose. They will eat anything that they can catch. At this age, it would be eating small fish, tadpoles, insects. As they get bigger prey. Adult alligators really like nutria. You know, they look like huge, big rats. And that's one of their favorite foods here. We're glad for that because nutria are dangerous to our environment.
We're looking at a small alligator here, but how large would a large adult male alligator run out to be?
The record in the United States was found in Louisiana about 100 years ago was 19 feet 3 inches.
19 feet.
Whoa. The official record in Texas right now is 14 feet 6 inches. It's against the law to kill alligators. They're living to be longer, and they grow their entire life. The older they are, the longer they are.
Thanks, Miss Ruby, for sharing your incredible knowledge about American alligators with us. Wasn't that cool? Now we're going to share a map with you to show you how you can get to Anahuac and Brazoria National Wildlife Refuges, so you can go out for yourself to see all these interesting species. Both refuges are about an hour outside of Houston. Like I said earlier, both are open sunrise to sunset and free of charge for you to visit and enjoy nature. In closing, we want to share some ways that you can help wetlands and wildlife. Here's two simple things that you can do, and they're all about litter. First, don't throw your chewing gum on the ground. Wildlife can get it stuck on their feathers or fur, and they can't fly or move. Chewing gum can be very dangerous for them, so enjoy it, and when you're done, throw it in the trash can. Same goes for balloons. If not disposed of properly, balloons can travel hundreds and hundreds of miles and end up in a wetland. And then you know what happens? A fish or bird or another critter might mistake it for food. They might eat it or feed it to their babies, and that creates a whole lot of problems. Another problem is they can get tangled in the string and are unable to fly or swim away. Basically, if you want a really easy way to protect wildlife, don't litter. Pretty simple, huh? Thanks for joining us today for Wild Wetlands. Be sure to watch the credits for more information on how to find a national wildlife refuge and a real nature adventure. Thanks again, and see you later, alligator.